Father, as we come to your word, it's a very vast landscape, and there's no way we can enter into your presence through any portion of the word but to first bow before you and acknowledge that that which represents your thoughts, which are higher than our thoughts, and your ways are higher than our ways. As your word says in Isaiah 57, as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my thoughts higher than your thoughts, and my ways higher than your ways. So the only way we're going to derive any benefit from this, Lord, is that you sculpt this time in such a way that we can look back and we will have clearly not just heard your voice, but there's been an enlarged entry point for yourself into our spirit, soul, and bodies for you to possess your inheritance. And since we are your inheritance, as we see in Ephesians 1, the riches of glory of your inheritance in the saints, then you would have that today. You would have that in whatever measure. You would create these openings for your entrance to enlarge that place of capacity in our spirit and eventually in our soul and ultimately in our bodies. Luke 11, our bodies are full of light, even in this life. So we commit this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen. As I was thinking about today, reading through Joshua, the next chapter, chapter 10, I thought, well, I'll just keep reading up through the following chapters. And it's just one battle after the other. Warfare, slaughter. Is this what the saints need to hear? Lopping off people's heads, hamstringing horses, burning chariots with fire. What is all this about? And I felt, you know, I would like to somehow get out of the book of Joshua and get into something that is going to be more suitable to what I perceive God's people's needs would be in terms of this crisis and all the oppressive atmosphere. I just waited on the Lord on that, and I said, I'm available to be adjusted any way you want on this. When I woke up this morning, I reviewed those passages, and the Lord just began to sculpt his interpretation for these Old Testament passages of how they are to be understood in the light of the New Covenant, how they are to be understood in the light of our spiritual warfare. Our warfare is not with flesh and blood. We know that from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 12 and following. But it's with principalities and powers, with the world rulers of darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. And as we read through Joshua, the counterpart is found there in Ephesians. And we see that also a counterpart in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty before God, bringing down strongholds and every thought that rises itself against the knowledge of God. We see our spiritual warfare is around the mind. It's around engaging these high-level forces in the heavenly places. And I would just say this, the Ephesians 6 battle, not every Christian is in that battle in the sense in which Paul was presenting it. Ephesians 6 already assumes that you're on resurrection ascension ground. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4, you've been made alive together with Christ, 1, that's new birth, raised together with Christ, that means you pass through the Jordan and you're on resurrection ground experientially, and seated with Christ in heavenly places, that means resurrection has resulted in an ascension union on an experiential level, and in that ascension union, you are now in a position where the principalities and powers are operating in the heavenly places, and you're now engaging at that level. Because if you're carnal or living in a state of carnality or the state and condition of the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 through 4, where their mindset was they were governed by the spirit of the age, the zeitgeist, as the Germans would say, the wisdom of man, the wisdom of this age, the wisdom of this world. Those three statements are found in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 through chapter 4. And Paul was having to deal with that and confront the fact that these Corinthians, after 5 years, a huge contradistinction between the church of Thessalonica, he'd been there 3 weeks or so, and look at their state and condition in 1 Thessalonians 1 and 2. They're a template for all the churches in northern and southern Greece in terms of their example, in terms of their aligning themselves with the purpose of God. The Corinthians were laggards. They were carnal, and after 5 years, they said, I couldn't speak to you as with spiritual men and women of God, 1 Corinthians 3, but as to carnal babes in Christ, for you have need of milk. You can't even handle strong meat. That's the same issue that we see with many that the apostle, most likely Apollos, he was addressing by the Holy Spirit in Hebrews 5:11 through 14, that they ought to be teachers by now, and yet they were carnal babes. They hadn't gone on to perfection. Why? They'd gone back to Torah observance. They were leaving, assembling themselves together and going back to the temple, which was about to be destroyed. We are living in a time where we have these parallels. God forbid that we should be like the Corinthians, carnal Christians, who are still babes. They don't have the battle that we see those addressed in Ephesians. The Ephesian saints, as they were being addressed, were functional in terms of heavenly places in Christ. The Corinthians were not operating experientially in those heavenly places. So we're going to pick up there, and as we revisit the book of Judges, I came across something that I thought was quite amazing. It's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, just a short phrase that is given there. Paul, in addressing the Corinthians, in 1 Corinthians verse 13, just talked about Apollos, our brother. Encourage him greatly to come to you, brethren, and it was not at all his desire to come to you, but he will come when he has opportunity. There's no evidence he ever came. Here it is, 1 Corinthians 16, verse 13. Be on the alert. Gregorio means be awake. Be aware of your surroundings. Know where you are in history. Be like the sons of Issachar in 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 32a. Be alert. Be awake. Stand firm in the faith. Act like men and be strong. Do you know where Paul got that? You know where he got that statement? From the Septuagint translation of Joshua chapter 1. Act like men, andridzomai. And so I thought I would look that up as I was thinking about this morning. We're going to have several sessions of this. I don't know how long the Lord's going to have us camped out here. I looked up the linguistic key to the Greek New Testament on 1 Corinthians 6:13. Gregoreo, to watch, to stay awake, to be alert. The present imperative is a command for habitual action. And the next word is stand firm. It's a perfect tense. That means you reach a place in your spiritual life where you're standing and you're in the good of that. It emphasizes present results. Get to that place where you're stable, standing, and you're stabilized in that standing firm. Perfect tense from the verb. The third one is act like men. Andridzomai, it's a present middle of the verb, andridzomai. It means to conduct oneself in a manly or courageous way. The word is common in the Septuagint in exhortations. See Joshua 1:6, 1:7, and 9. Wow, I looked at that. I looked at the Septuagint Greek, and there it is. Three times, andridzomai. And eschool, to receive the empowerment of God so that you're actively walking in the dunamis of God, eschool. It's actually there. And then goes on to say, Aristotle, which is an ancient Greek writer, uses the word indicating the display of courage, which he describes as the mean between fear and confidence. The word was also used in the papyri, that is, the ancient Greek writings recorded on papyrus scrolls. It was used in the papyri in an exhortation, quote, therefore, do not be faint-hearted, but be courageous as a man. And Paul was writing the Corinthians, which included men and women. And so I went back to that passage that Paul was very familiar with, the Greek Septuagint and the book of Joshua, and looked it up. So we'll just revisit that because this is the foundation of Joshua's commission. We'll turn to the passage in Joshua chapter 1 and just read that one section by way of a review of his commission by our Lord. And Moses was the mouthpiece for that commission as well. By the way, when I was in the Septuagint, it has Jesus as the translation of Yeshua, Joshua. Jesus is the Greek term for Jesus. So as we look at who Joshua is, the Greek would be Jesus, translate Jesus. So I have the authoritative Greek English lexicon of the New Testament by Walter Bauer. And I looked up Jesus on page 375. Here's what it says. I thought this was just what a revelatory realization. Jesus, and then it gives the Hebrew Yeshua in the later form, Yehoshua, that would be the later form for the name of Jesus, his human name. And then the very first entry in the lexicon has this, one under Jesus, Jesus, Joshua, successor of Moses, and military leader of the people when they entered Canaan. Military leader. So who's the greater Joshua? Look at Hebrews chapter 3, 4 on. We see Joshua did not give them rest. Look at Hebrews 3, 7 through chapter 4, verse 13. Joshua didn't give them rest. Yeshua of the Old Testament. But Jesus is the place where the Father has found rest. And Jesus is the commander-in-chief of the armies. He's seated at the right hand of the Father, so he is personally present in the Holy Spirit as the commander-in-chief. And we see that in the book of the Acts. Jesus, the things that he began to do and teach, first advent, if you completed the sentence, he continued to do and teach in the person of his other self, the Holy Spirit, sent down from heaven, released through the apostles, and we see the expansion of the church throughout the book of Acts. And all the enemies of God and all that which opposed Jesus building the church in the book of Acts were 100% defeated. They were defeated. All opposition, Paul being thrown into prison there at Philippi, him and Barnabas, and yet look at the church that came out of there. Wow. Satan can throw his worst attacks, and God allows those attacks to be there so the church can become andrizomai. Act like men, be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. So, that verse in 1 Corinthians 16:13, this is what Paul had in mind. Three times andrizomai is used in the Greek translation, the Septuagint of the Hebrew Bible, and I'll read that passage beginning with Joshua chapter 1, verses 5 through 9. No man will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I have been with Moses, I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. The greater Jesus and the person of the Holy Spirit is now in us as the greater Joshua. Okay? He's in us. Not this Joshua. Yeshua HaMashiach, the Lord himself. Be strong and courageous. Isku andrizomai. Isku, that's the word for imparted strength that comes from the dunamis, the power of God. The word courageous in the Greek translation is andrizomai. Be very courageous, andrizomai. In fact, in the Septuagint, the English translation, it says act like men. That's actually what it says in the Septuagint translation into the English. Act like men. Be very careful to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you, and do not turn from it to the right or to the left so that you may have success. Sakal means to have the wisdom to act wisely and to execute the plan, to have success wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it, ruminate. Let it saturate you day and night, that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it, for then you will make your way prosperous, then you will have success. You will have the wisdom that will result in success. Sakel. Have I not commanded you? Third time, Isku, be strong and courageous. Andrizomai, do not tremble or be dismayed. Tremble is the effects of fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear, cowardice, but a power, love, and sound mind, 2 Timothy 1, verse 7, or be dismayed. The Hebrew means shattered and demoralized by terror. Shattered and demoralized by terror. That's dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Did he see the Lord? No. What did he have as assurance? The Lord is with him. The Word of God. That's what he had. So you shut up to faith as it relates to the actual experiential realization of this. He had to walk out by faith that which represents the fulfillment of these commands that he received from the Lord. Let's turn to Joshua chapter 10. We already noted the unfolding of Joshua's leadership and leading the children of Israel into the inheritance. And remember, it was Joshua and Eleazar the high priest. There was a priestly connection with all that which represented the advance of God's people. You'll see the interface between the high priest and Joshua through the whole campaign. It's right there in the text. In chapter 10, the stratagem, and when the enemy on a frontal assault was dealt with at Ai, they were taken down. And then we see the enemies. We've heard about this. And chapter 9, all the kings were gathered together with one accord to fight with Joshua and Israel. That's Joshua 9, verse 2. And then there's a parenthesis. We have this whole infiltration. Who are these? These are not sons of Israel. These are not God's covenant people. They're not sons of God. they're there as a reminder that you do not take counsel of the Lord, you're going to have a carnal element in your midst. Yes, they're serving the children of Israel. They're there as servants, but they should have never been there in the first place. They're there as a reminder to keep them humble that you have to deal with this. You have to be reminded by this carnal lack of sonship characteristics in your midst. These are not the sons of God in terms of covenant relationship. And there they are in the midst. That brings them to a place of deeper repentance and deeper dependence upon the Lord. We saw in 9:14 that they did not seek the counsel of the Lord. In 9:1 and 2, all these vast armies are ready for a massive assault to overwhelm by sheer force. But then we have this kind of a parenthetical reference in Joshua that deals with the Gibeonites. Then in chapter 10, we pick up again these massive forces that are there to overwhelm Israel and to destroy them if possible. These are human. These are flesh and blood forces. And so we pick up this battle again in full force. And if we follow through right up through chapter 14, all these various armies and their kings, they align themselves. They come together to fight against Israel. Because Israel carries the seed of the woman, Genesis 3:15, that will be the modality, the means by which, as the people of God, the Messiah will come into the world to bring salvation. So Satan is stirring up these enemies to wipe out the seed of the woman as represented in the descendants of Abraham here in the land of Canaan. So we'll just begin noting a few things. I'll be reading. We have a lot to cover. And what we can't cover today, we'll trust the Lord for the next time we gather together. We'll start with chapter 10 and verse 1. Now it came about when Adoni Zedek, the king of Jerusalem, heard that Joshua had captured Ai and had utterly destroyed it. That is, it was put under the ban. It was devoted to God for destruction. That's what Karam means. It was devoted to destruction. And just as he had done to Jericho and its king, so he had done to Ai and its king. You have to deal with the ruling prince of that locality if you're going to defeat that particular domain of enemy occupying God's inheritance, that is, the children of Israel's inheritance in Canaan. You got to deal with kings if you're going to dispossess the enemy. So who are the kings we're dealing with? These are principalities and powers. These are not demons. Demons are not kings. Principalities and powers. Rulers of forces of the present darkness. Satan is a king. He's the king of all those who are proud. He rules over all the sons of arrogance. He's king. Last verse of Job chapter 41. He is a king. And we see who he is as king there in Ezekiel 28. There's the prince of Sidon. And then we see the king behind it, Satan himself. So he is a king. And we have to deal with King Satan if we're going to see people set free and these kings displaced so the people of God can come into the fullness of their inheritance in Christ. It's in heavenly places. And Jesus Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father, enthroned in the third heavens. And we are here underneath the first heavens. And our life is hidden with Christ in God, Colossians 3:1-4. But our feet are right here on terra firma. And if we are going to come into full possession of our inheritance in Christ, which is in the third heaven, we have to pass through the second heavens. We have to confront these kings. And not everybody's up to it. It's only the Andrizomai crowd. It's only those who are willing to be strong in the Lord and the strength of His might, as we see in Ephesians chapter 6. Habitually, it is a command, en dunamao, to continually receive, which is grace, be empowered from within through your union with the Lord and in the strength of His might. Again, all the various words there which we looked at in the past for power. The inhabitants of Gideon, verse 1, had made peace with Israel and were within their land. The Gibeonites were once a part of these other nations. They've surrendered, and that's a provocation for war. There's going to be retaliation. And that he, that is the king of Jerusalem, feared greatly because Gibeon was a great city and one of the royal cities, and because it was greater than Ai, and all the men were mighty. That conquest brought about great fear on the confederacy of nations that were there to wipe out the seed of the woman through corrupting the seed of Abraham. Therefore, Adoni Zedek of Jerusalem sent word to Poham, king of Hebron, and to Piram, king of Jarmuth, and to Japhia, king of Lachish, and to Debir, king of Eglon, saying, Come up to me and help me. Let us attack Gibeon, for it has made peace with Joshua and with the sons of Israel. The five kings of the Amorites. By the way, Amorites is really a collective term for all the tribes that were within the territory of Israel. There are other different groups, but that's usually as a collective term. The five kings of the Amorites, and then we see of that, the Amorites, collective term for various tribes occupying the Promised Land. We have the king of Jerusalem, the king of Hebron, king of Jarmuth, the king of Lachish, and the king of Eglon. They gathered together and went up, and with all their armies encamped at Gibeon, and fought against it. So they're going after the Quislings, those that were once a part of the enemies of Israel, and now they are willing to be subservient. So they're going to send a message. You become a Quisling, you become a traitor, you're going to pay. Then the men of Gibeon went to Joshua, to the camp at Gilgal. Notice, Gilgal, that's the place of circumcision. If you're going to go in and occupy the land, you got to come back to base camp. And remember, any uncircumcised flesh will not have the strength to go in and take possession of the land. We see in Colossians chapter 3, 5, put to death your members that are on the earth. And then it gives the list of the carnality there. And by the way, I've got an email from a person who is seeking help. He's still going to prostitutes. He's involved in pornography. He's not in the second heaven warfare. He's in a place of such compromise that he's going to be dealing primarily with unclean spirits and the demonic. The principalities, the powers don't need to bother with him because he's still functioning on the other side of the Jordan. He's still in the wilderness. And he's not dealing with principalities and powers because he has not put to death those members that are here on the earth. Colossians 3:5, put to death. So as we're going to see all the way through Joshua put to death these carnal elements that were coming against the children of Israel. And he was thorough about it. We're going to see this. Verse 6, then the men of Gibeon sent word to Joshua to the camp of Gilgal, saying, Do not abandon your servants. Come up to us quickly and save us, deliver us, and help us. For all the kings of the Amorites, the inhabitants of Canaan that live in the hill country, have assembled against us. So the Gibeonites know they're in serious trouble. All those armies that are not only the enemies of Israel are now going after the Gibeonites. So Joshua went up from Gilgal, he and all the people of war with him, and all the valiant warriors. You see, when you're on the other side of Jordan, you're on that which is typically resurrection ground. So you're not really functioning as a warrior till you're on resurrection ground. That's Ephesians, first three chapters. That's resurrection ground. And the Lord said to Joshua, Do not fear them, for I have given them into your hands. Not one of them shall stand before you. Exactly what he said when he commissioned him in Joshua 1. So Joshua came upon them suddenly by marching all night from Gilgal, from the place where the reproach of Egypt and the flesh was removed. And the Lord confounded them before Israel. Notice the Lord. And he slew them with a great slaughter at Gibeon, and pursued them by way of ascent to Beth Horon, and struck them as far as Azek and Baqeda. Who did it? The Lord did. He did it through Joshua and the armies. But where was their strength coming from? Their strength was coming from the Lord. So the Lord gets the credit for the battle, but who was actually physically in the battle? Joshua and the men of war. So we're in spiritual conflict, we're in battle, but everything that we are involved with, if we're in the name of the Lord and representing His purpose, then He is there in us and through us fighting. And Jesus in us by the Holy Spirit is the Commander-in-Chief. We're seeing that more and more, and that's what I look for. As we go into battle and we clear off this ground with people that are captured through generational SRDID, that ground, which is captured humanity when it comes forward, keeps being released, filling in, filling in, filling in, filling in. Eventually, that which was a compartmentalized, layered Jebusite fortress, enemy territory, incrementally is being dismantled. When that humanity is released, it becomes the place where the Lord can occupy, and then that person becomes a weapon of the Lord. But to take those places, we're not dealing with demons. They're not a difficulty at all. For me, personally, I can only speak for me, they're not a challenge at all. They don't even show up anymore. It's the principalities that you have to deal with. And they're glued in there. They're enmeshed. They're attached to the human spirit. They're so one with the person's identity, they can't tell the difference between what's true humanity and what is, on a spiritual level, the identity of a principality. This takes a specific understanding of how to deal with this. God is teaching others and us, teaching us for years. It says in verse 11, and it came about when they fled from before Israel, while they were at the descent of Beth Horon, that the Lord threw large stones from heaven. Now here's providence. In other words, the armies of Israel are fighting, but they need assistance. So God threw these large hailstones from heaven as far as Azekah, and they died. Now watch this. There were more who died from the hailstones than those whom the sons of Israel killed with the sword. So you want providence on your side? Be in his war. Fight in his battles. When you read this verse, any hailstorms on the other side of the Jordan? You see any hailstorms helping the children of Israel while they're still wandering around in the wilderness? No, they have to deal with the carnal flesh. They have uncircumcised hearts. Circumcised in the flesh, but their hearts aren't circumcised. So that's a tremendous thing to say. More died by providential intervention than those whom the sons of Israel killed with a sword. They'd learned their lessons. The fiasco at the Gibeonites, God overruled this. They are brought into humility and submission to the Lord. God providentially overrules their complicity with the Gibeonites, and he brings victory. Now watch this. Then Joshua spoke to the Lord. This is one of the most phenomenal passages in the entire Bible to me. We're going to unpack this a little bit because it has shocking ramifications for the last days. So let's just read it. Then Joshua spoke to the Lord. Now the Lord's been speaking to Joshua, and Joshua has been carrying out the commands. But we have a retrospective consideration here. What is the backdrop to this success in this military campaign? Joshua spoke to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the sons of Israel, and he said in the sight of Israel. In other words, what we just read in the first 11 chapters, let's look into the background. There's not only hailstones, which is God's providential intervention on behalf of the children of Israel, who are united as one man to dispossess the enemies and to gain possession of their inheritance. But we see Joshua. He's there in the background. And Joshua spoke to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the sons of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, O sun, stand still at Gibeon. There's a big battle going to take place here at Gibeon. All these armies are coming. We need light to fight. We need light from the sun-son to fight. O sun, stand still at Gibeon. Now, the sun that we are referring to is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he's always shining. He is never stopped. He is firmly in place, and that sun never goes down. It's only eclipsed by unbelief and the carnal works of the flesh. O sun, stand still at Gibeon. O moon in the valley of Ajalon. In other words, night, you're not coming in here. Sun rules, Genesis chapter 1, the sun rules the day, the moon at night. No night here. Night's not coming in. So the sun stood still and the moon stopped. Light was dominant. Darkness was held back until the nation avenged themselves of their enemies. Now, as we approach the end, with the next COVID round coming up in the fall, first phase of the vaccinations, it may be optional, but the second phase, you will be taken into a FEMA camp if you do not submit. It's already in place. We are facing the end game. It is coming down in a torrent. You see the enemy surrounding the children of Israel here? The church is surrounded. It's closing in. The church is surrounded by the enemies of God. Here, the attack is on the people of God, but it's actually an attack upon the Lord indirectly. The sun stood still and the moon stopped until the nation avenged themselves of their enemies. Is it not written in the book of Jasher? We have interesting reference there in chapter 13. In Kings, you have the records of the sons of Israel and the sons of Jacob, and there's a record that God kept of their upright deeds. Jasher means upright, the record of the upright ones. There's these books that we don't have today, but there are in the pseudepigraphal writings, we do have some of the remnants. So I won't go there, but they're actual books. The book of the upright ones. And the sun stopped in the middle of the sky and did not hasten to go down for about a whole day. For those who might be interested, go ahead and pick up a commentary on this. You cannot believe the human viewpoint in commentaries. Well, this is just hyperbole. This is just poetic reference. Why? Because stellar mechanics, the movements of the bodies in the heaven, the earth moving around the sun in orbit, traveling 66,000 miles an hour, it's rotating on its axis 1,000 miles an hour. Its rotation determines the length of the days. Its orbit around the earth is based upon a very specifically timed speed. So the centripetal force, we don't go into the sun, and the centrifugal force, we don't go out into space and freeze to death. It's a very carefully tuned mechanism, all these stellar mechanics. Now you tell me, scientist, go ahead, how do you figure this one out? How in the world do you stop the Earth in its orbit, and it doesn't fall into the sun or flung out into space? When you look at centripetal and centrifugal mechanics, gravitational mechanics, it's not possible. There is no scientific logic that can explain this. And your commentators try to come up with, well, this is just hyperbole. This doesn't really mean what it says. Yes, it does mean what it says. It means God can stop the earth and take responsibility for violating all the celestial mechanics and the movement of the stars, and things just continue to go on. This is such a massive miracle. It is beyond any comprehension of anyone that understands astrophysics, astronomy, the mechanics of how the bodies of the heavens move. This is impossible. But what does the Word of God say? God did a miracle. And it is beyond human comprehension. So the text means what it says. Forget the commentators, and that's what they are, commentators. Their human viewpoint just means they can't comprehend this act, so they try to come up with some explanation. Like it's just some form of poetic hyperbole. It is not. It is what it says. The sun did not go down for about a whole day. Verse 14. This even emphasizes the fact that there was never a miracle like this ever in the history of mankind, and there was no day like that before it or after it, when the Lord listened to the voice of a man. The Lord fought for Israel. Verse 12, Joshua spoke to the Lord in that day. He did executive warfare. Psalm 149, verse 5. He executed the judgment written. He spoke the word. It was the word of Joshua. And what does it say? There was no day like it before when the Lord listened to the voice of a man. That's the day we're looking for today. Where is the man that the Lord will listen to today, saints? Where is that man? Where is that assembly that the Lord will listen to that voice? Ask yourself. Do you want to be with assembly like that? May God raise up in the earth remnant assemblies, so when they pray and they speak, the Lord says, let it be done according to my friends in that assembly. I have friends there. 2 John and 3 John, I have friends. Let us think about it, because we're not quite there yet, church. But the days are coming when we're going to see activities that we've never seen in the history of mankind. We're going to see the providential intervention. We're going to see that which represents what has been an Ishmael before the Isaac, you know, the name it and claim it, the hyper-faith movement. That was an Ishmael before the Isaac. We will see events like we see in the Gospels being fleshed out prior to the rapture of the church. We're going to see providential intervention. Without it, in our condition right now, we're sunk. You look at our condition right now, look how pathetic the church is now. It's anemic. The church is capitulating to shelter and stay at home. Why? Well, the state says so. We have to bow. We have to kowtow to the state. You don't find that in Acts chapter 4. You don't find them kowtowing to the government in Acts chapter 4. So at some point, the church is going to stand up and say, we're not subject to man's law. We have orders from the Lord. May God make us strong and courageous as we face the days ahead. And it's only as we are moving into His territory, His unclaimed territory in Christ, only as we are moving in and occupying that territory by displacing principalities and powers, striking them down, waging holy war against Hasatan and his host. No cowardice. Fighting the wars of the Lord, like Abigail said to David. You are fighting the Lord's battles, David. So may God raise up Davids in our generation. So think of that. No day like it. The Lord listened to the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. So you need to have a voice like Joshua, and somehow the Lord is drawn into the fight in a way that we call providence. To what degree are we going to be in that place where the voice of man gets the attention of the Lord? Then Joshua and all Israel with him returned to the camp of Gilgal. Don't forget, we only gain ground as we recognize that we have been circumcised in the circumcision of Christ. Colossians 2:11-15. And in that circumcision, Colossians 2:11, is the ground in which principalities and powers are stripped off. Colossians 2:15. That's awesome. That's a mind blower to me. To even think like this is totally supernatural. None of this can come from man. Now the five kings had fled and hidden themselves in the cave of Makkedah. Five kings. Why are they hiding? Because when you're strong in the Lord and the strength of His might, did you know that Satan has fear? He's afraid of those who know their God and do exploits, Daniel chapter 11. He's afraid. He's a creature. And often when he's afraid to lose his territory, he projects his fear into a person's DID system to keep them from going to that place where he's about to be exposed and removed. So don't accept all fear is yours. You may be getting close to something that when you reclaim it, that fear will leave, because the satanic source fear is afraid of losing you as an asset, and he's going to be removed. That ground is lost forever. So much we could go there. The voice of man. What kind of men do people even listen to? Well, we've noted in the past, remember in Exodus 32, I'm not going to read the whole passage, we just looked at that recently. The children of Israel, Moses has gone up to get the tablets of the law. He's on the mountain, and the children of Israel are upset. Where's the Lord? What happened to Moses? And they go into idolatry. They make this golden calf. We looked at that in the past. How does God respond when Moses heard about all the commotion in the camp? Here's all this orgiastic activity, and Joshua says, it sounds like war. Well, that was his mindset, because he knew we were in warfare, but he didn't understand that the warfare was that the people of God were defeated and Aaron had capitulated to this idolatrous idea to create a golden calf. The Lord says, get out of the way, Moses, I'm going to wipe out this people, and I'll start with you. I'll begin a new nation from you. And the Lord drew out Moses, that's his name, we looked at that. And when Moses appealed to the name of the Lord, what about your great name? What about the promise you made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? What are your enemies going to say? You're able to bring them out, but you're not able to bring them in. What about your reputation, Lord? I don't have a need for you to make a nation on me. I'm not some kind of a narcissist that I have some kind of a need for recognition. I don't have a name. It's your name. My name means nothing. It's your name, Lord. What about your great name? Verse 14 of Exodus 32. So, the Lord changed his mind about the harm which he had said he would do to his people. He relented. The Hebrew says he repented. Interesting. And then one other place, and then we can move on. There's an incident in the life of Elijah in 1 Kings 17. And we know that he went to Zarephath. The Hebrew means a place of smelting. Starvation, judgment was there. Remember, there's a famine. And this woman and her son were gathering sticks and they were getting ready to eat their last meal and die. Last meal. Prophet shows up and he says to her, the food that she was preparing to eat with her and her son, he said in verse 12, "As the Lord your God lives, I have no bread," she said to Joshua, because he said in verse 11, and she was going to get the bread and the water, and he, the prophet, called to her and said, "Please bring me a piece of bread in your hand." Now it's her last piece. Now the prophet says, "Give it to me." That would spell a quicker death for her. "Give the bread to me." What does that sound like to you? Does that sound like someone who's being considered, or someone's about to die? No, this is a man of faith. "You give it to me. You give it to me." He's testing her. But she said, "As the Lord your God lives, I have no bread, only a handful of flour in a bowl and a little oil in the jar. And behold, I am gathering a few sticks that I may go in and prepare for me and my son, that we may eat it and die." That's 1 Kings 17, verse 12. Then Elijah said to her, "Do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but make me a little bread cake from it first, and bring it out to me, and afterward you may make one for yourself and your son." Now this is a stretch of faith. It's probably a very small portion. Notice, "For thus says the Lord God of Israel." This is really no different than Joshua. This is a statement of faith. He knows he's in the will of God. He's told he's to go there. He's led by the Lord there. So he knows that because of his mission and commission in the will of God, he just knows. And so he can speak with assurance without bowing his head, "Lord, what do I do in this situation?" He speaks what looks like presumptuously. But it's really a level of faith that few of us even have understood yet. But we will enter into in the days ahead as a part of his remnant. "For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bowl of flour shall not be exhausted, nor shall the jar of oil be empty until the day that the Lord sends rain on the face of the earth." So she went and did according to the word of who? The word of the Lord? The word of Elijah. Just like we saw with Joshua. According to the word of Elijah. And she and he and her household ate for many days. The bowl of flour was not exhausted, nor did the jar of oil become empty, according to the word of the Lord. Just like with Joshua, the word of man and the word of the Lord synchronized. That's called spiritual authority, friends. That's called priestly ministry. That's called fellowship, intimacy. That means that we're walking in such a way that our intuition and the Spirit of God is so one. We don't fully always know where God leaves off and we begin. And that's the way it should be. We walk by faith. And we look back, we say, "The Lord did it." When we're in the middle of it, we did it. We're trusting the Lord by faith, we're doing it. We look back, "The Lord did it." And that's exactly what we see here. "The flour was not exhausted, nor did the jar of oil become empty, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke through Elijah." He spoke through Elijah. See, the same thing with Joshua in Joshua chapter 10. Some of the lessons we come away from that are probably pretty vast. Where would we even begin? But when we look at the landscape and where we are in history, something of a prophetic nature is going to need to come into actual manifestation as we approach the increasingly dark days, and the enemies of God and the enemies of the Church of Jesus Christ are pressing in to do what? Wipe us out. The vaccine, sheltering in place. This is number one. It is a satanic source attack against the body and bride of Christ. We are under an assault that is not going to be fully resolved until 1 Thessalonians 1:10. When the Lord descends from heaven, he rescues us from the wrath to come. The rapture is a divine rescue. Rescue from what? Death. Death. Those who are alive, and those who are the surviving remnant, Ephesians 4:15 and 17. Perilepomai, the Greek says, they survive death. There's a sentence of death against the body of Christ. Just like Jesus, the seed of the woman, he came in the world. Herod the Great went after all the little children, 2 years old and under, to get to that seed in the surrounding environs. Satan is after the seed. That was the seed of the woman. But we, 1 John 3, we have his seed in us. You know that, don't you? When we're born again, we have the seed, the sperma of God himself. 1 John 3, verse 9. No one who is begotten of God, that represents our new birth identity, habitually practices sin. Why? Because if you do, Hebrews 12, whom the Lord loves, he disciplines, and he scourges every son he receives. And if you're without discipline, you are illegitimate. If you're begotten of God, that seed is there, and there's either repentance, or like the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 11, verse 30, they were dying to sin unto death. You cannot habitually practice sin with the seed of God in you. The seed itself cannot sin. That divine life, that new birth identity, that new creation identity, that which is begotten of God, no one who is begotten of God habitually practices sin. Why? Because his sperma abides in him. That's the seed of Christ. This is Isaiah 53:10. The Lord will see his seed. So Jesus is the seed of the woman. That's come. He's glorified. Now Jesus has seed. And that seed is the man-child, by the way, when it comes to maturity, is caught up to God in the throne of Revelation 12. So his seed. What does that mean to have the seed of Messiah in us? Galatians chapter 3, verse 29, 3:16, Jesus is the seed singular of the woman. And Galatians 3, 29, we are Abraham's offspring. We're his seed. This seed of Christ is in us. First time in history. That never happened until Pentecost. He will see his seed and prolong his days, and the hand of the Lord will prosper through him. That seed became deposited at new birth right there at Pentecost. We know from 1 Peter chapter 1, 3, prior to Pentecost, no one was ever born again. They had a faith relationship with God. They were redeemed. But being born again through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, could not happen until Jesus Christ was raised. So now he's raised, that seed comes in to God's people, and now the object of the seed war from 3:15, Genesis 6, 1 through 4, and all the way throughout Israel's history, now becomes objectified in a new vessel. He couldn't destroy Jesus Christ. That phase of the seed war is over. Now, phase two of the seed war, the seed of Christ is in the people of God, the church of God. The seed of Messiah was not in the old covenant people. That seed is the seed of the woman. Now we have the actual seed of Messiah in us. That triggers immense warfare. So as you're keeping up to date on Mr. Sparks, that latest thing that I mentioned to you, the deliverance of the Lord in the day of death, you have that, chapters 1 and 2, it's being posted now. It's tremendous. And as we're going to be looking at more into the sequence of the warfare in Joshua, we'll see the counterpart in David's mighty men and attaining under the first three. Those articles will be posted on the website for you to take time to dig in and really meditate and renew your mind. We are at war, and if we are going to be able to stand the final battle, we need to be equipped. We need to be thinking God's thoughts. We need to understand what it is to become a partaker of the divine nature, so that as we more and more become a partaker of the divine nature, as we're escaping the lusts of the world according to the flesh, 2 Peter chapter 1, then we become a partaker of the divine nature, and when that reaches a specific criteria that is only known to God, the morning star will begin to arise in that domain of the divine nature, as we see in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. And those people, we know from 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, will be making known the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that will be evidence of the morning star. So we're not there yet. We know from the example what is taught, Mark 8, the passage where Jesus commanded the disciples to get into a boat, and he goes up to a mountain and pray. And while they're in the boat, this big storm arises, and they're harassed by rowing. Jesus walking on the water, he gets into the boat, he commands, rebukes the wind, and there became a great calm, and they arrived at their destination. When did Jesus show up? Fourth watch of the night. When's the morning star going to appear? Fourth watch of the night. That means the people are going to be shut up to an extended faith until God chooses the time, the day of visitation, to bring forth his final closing testimony, which will signal to principalities and powers that their domain in the second heavens is about to be replaced and displaced forever. the goal of the inheritance. Those kings will be cast down, and the church of the living God will be the ruling aristocracy. Know you not, saints, you will judge the world. Know you not, you shall judge angels. 1 Corinthians 6:2-3. So God is preparing that. So as we see in verse 9, God's seed abides in him, and he cannot habitually sin because he is begotten of God. As we come to Joshua, just notice a few things in this chapter. I'll try to bring this to a conclusion as the Lord directs. Just read on, verse 16. The five kings fled and hid themselves in the cave of Makeda. They're under their fear. There may be a people rise up in the last days in the body of Christ where Satan is hiding. He's wanting to run. He's going to hold on to these strongholds, especially in the SRIDID community, as long as he can, because these are his shields. This is what protects him from the final carrying out of God's judgment against him. So he is going to hide where he can. But he needs to be on the defense. The people of God need to be on the ones on the offense. Here we go. And it was told Joshua, saying, the five kings, these rulers of these domains that represent the stronghold of the Canaanites in God's promised land, the five kings have been found hidden in the cave at Makeda. And Joshua said, roll a large stone against the mouth of the cave and assign men by it to guard it. They're on the defense. The people of God are on the offensive. But do not stay there yourselves. Pursue your enemies. Pursue your enemies. Pursue your enemies. You see? No passivity here. You pursue. You pursue. You don't stop pursuing. And we'll look at that more later on. Pursue. Even though you're weary, you keep pursuing. You keep pursuing. You keep pursuing until all the ground is occupied. As much ground as was possible during that time. It wasn't all taken. We can see in Judges, first two or three chapters in Judges, it wasn't all taken. There are consequences for that. That's like the first century church, and they have a whole church age because that ground in Christ was never fully entered into in the apostolic era. So we have a long history that is the unfolding of the church age, but now God's coming full circle to bring all this into realization through a remnant in Philadelphia that will be juxtaposed to the predominant characteristic features of the church age, Laodicea. So God is busy at work. Notice, you pursue your enemies. That's your business. Pursue your enemies and attack them in the rear. Do not allow them to enter their cities, for the Lord your God has delivered them into your hand. And it came about when Joshua and the sons of Israel had finished slaying them with a very great slaughter until they were destroyed, and the survivors who remained of them had entered the fortified cities. Remember, the enemy has fortified places. And what fortified places does he have in the people of God, especially those who are generational SRIDID? He slayed them with a very great slaughter until they were destroyed, and the survivors who remained of them had entered their fortified cities, that all the people returned to the camp to Joshua at Makeda in peace. No one uttered a word against any of the sons of Israel. There's unity there. There's fear. There's fear. Like we see when Ananias and Sapphira dropped dead, I like the King James. No one dare join themselves as the people of God. Great fear came upon them because God was present. We see the narrative, and we pick up verse 28. Now Joshua captured Makeda on that day and struck it, and its king, with the edge of the sword, he utterly destroyed it, and every person who was in it, he left no survivor. You know what this is? This is thoroughness. This is dealing with enemies for us. The ground in us is flesh, but behind that is the principalities and powers. As the cross deals with the flesh in us, not only carnal flesh, but the natural man, then the ground for these principalities and powers is being lost, and these kings are coming down. Notice he says, they were destroyed. There was no survivor. Thus they did to the king of Makeda, just as he had done to the king of Jericho. So there's the initial foundation for victory, faith. Then Joshua and all Israel with him passed from Makeda to Libna and fought against Israel, and the Lord gave it also, and with its king, that means the principality behind this king had to be dealt with. This is the flesh and blood battle for them, for us. The kings have to do with any territory that we need to dispossess. There will be some principality there saying, you're not coming in here. The Lord delivered this king into his hand, the hands of Israel, and he struck it and every person who was in it under the jurisdiction of that king with the edge of the sword. He left no survivor. He left no survivor. Thus he did to its king just as he had done to the king of Jericho. Again, this is the victory that overcomes the world, even your faith. Verse 36, then Joshua and all Israel within went up to the next territory, the next place, the next stronghold, Eglon to Hebron, and they fought against it, and they captured it and struck it, and its king, and all its cities, all of the persons who were in it with the edge of the sword. He left no survivor. In other words, for us, we put off the deeds of the flesh, put off the deeds of darkness, and make no provision for the flesh. We left no survivor according to all that he had done to Eglon, and he utterly destroyed it, and every person who was in it. Wow. Talk about thoroughness. And talking about the fear of the Lord. Look at verse 40. And thus Joshua struck all the land, the hill country, and the Negev in the south, the lowland, and the slopes, and all their kings. He left no survivor, but he utterly destroyed. He devoted them to the destruction as commanded by the Lord through Moses. And he destroyed all who breathed, just as the Lord, the God of Israel, had commanded. And Joshua struck them from Kadesh Barnea, which was the original entry point into the land of Canaan, as far as Gaza, and all the country of Goshen, even as far as Gibeon. By the way, they never drove all the giants and the remnants out of Gaza, and Gaza is still in the hands of enemy territory now. They didn't carry through their original command. And Joshua captured all these kings and their lands at one time, because the Lord, the God of Israel, fought for Israel. So Joshua and all Israel with him returned to the camp at Gilgal. Back to the practical reminder that it's uncircumcised flesh. There's no place on resurrection ground. There's no place where you can stand as an uncircumcised Philistine in your flesh for these kings. You go down. They learned that at Ai. If you look at chapter 11, I'm not going into all of this, but this next stronghold is Hazor. But just notice a few things here, and I will try to wrap this up as much as I can. We're leaving out a lot of details and focusing on the fact, what is the heart of the battle, and who is Joshua, and what is the objective, and what are the characteristics that describe this unified army going in and dispossessing the enemies and taking possession and inheritance. Then it came about when Jabin, king of Hazor, and as I said, there's a lot of details that I'm leaving behind because I want us to stay focused on what we're listening to today. He says that Jabin, king of Hazor, heard of it, of this defeat. He sent Joab, king of Madon, and to the king of Shimron, and to the king of Akshaph, and to the kings who were in the north in the hill country, and in the Arabah, the south, south of Kimmeroth, and in the lowland, and on the heights of Dor in the west, and the Canaanites. So this is a comprehensive. The enemy is not slacking up. There's terror in those kings, but the enemy is stirred up, and he's ready for a counterattack. He's not giving up. So we see the Canaanites are mentioned on the east and on the west, and the Amorite, and the Hittite, and the Perizzite, and the Jebusite, and the hill country, the Hivite, at the foot of Hermon, in the land of Mizpah, and they came out, and they and all their armies with them, as many people as the sand that is on the seashore, with very many horses and chariots. So all these kings agreed to meet, and came and encamped together the waters of Merom to fight against Israel, to fight against the people of God. You're not coming in here. There's a seed war. This land has hybridized inhabitants that are directly connected with Satan and the seed of the woman and through the seed of Abraham. You're not coming in. We occupy this territory and you're not coming in. It's a fight to the death. You can't negotiate with them. We can't negotiate with the flesh, which is the only nexus, the only means by which Satan can operate through us. When I say the flesh, I don't only mean the carnal flesh, I mean the natural man. Again, 1 Corinthians 1 to 4. Notice verse 10. And Joshua turned back at that time and captured Hazor, in spite of all this conspiracy, and struck its king with a sword, for Hazor formerly was the head of all these kingdoms. Wow! He took out the stronghold. He was the head of all these kingdoms. Amazing. Verse 15. Just as the Lord had commanded Moses, his servant, So Moses commanded Joshua, and so Joshua did. He left nothing undone of all that the Lord had commanded Moses. What an amazing testimony that is. In verse 16, thus Joshua took all that land, the hill country, and all the Negev, and all the land of Goshen, and the lowland, the Arabah, the hill country, Israel, and the lowland. Verse 18, Joshua waged war a long time with all these kings. A long war. Now, saints, who likes a long war? How about a furlough? Anybody interested in a furlough? That'd be nice, wouldn't it? Where are you going to go? It's okay to have a time of rest. But the enemies are not resting. We have a commission. And we have Joshua, the greater Joshua, in the person of the Holy Spirit indwelling us, saying basically, even though we may be like Joshua 13, verse 1, now Joshua was old and advanced in years when the Lord said to him, you are old and advanced in years, and very much of the land remains to be possessed. We're going to notice when we gather together next time an amazing stronghold that was still in Canaan that traced back to hybrids. The first generation of hybrids to populate the land of Canaan after the flood. There was a man named Caleb who says, I want that territory. It's called Hebron. That became in the future the stronghold of David. That's huge. And we're going to see Caleb wears the Congressional Medal of Honor, the highest military honor, for capturing Kiriath Arba. And it became Hebron, the transitional stronghold from Ziklag to all of Israel being united under David to make him king. A lot of lessons here, saints. Notice here as we conclude our time today, Joshua waged a long war with all of these kings. Verse 21, then Joshua came at that time and cut off the Anakim. Wow. Anak, the firstborn offspring of Arba, who was the firstborn offspring of the second incursion of Nephilim in the land of Canaan. Are you tracking with that? We'll unpack that more when we get together. The Anakim, these are the long necks. These are hybrids. And then Joshua came at that time and cut off the Anakim from the hill country, from Hebron, from Debir, Anab, and from all the hill country of Judah, and from all the hill country of Israel. Joshua utterly destroyed them with their cities. There were no Anakim left in the land of the sons of Israel, only in Gaza, in Gath. We know about the hybrid from Gath, don't we? Goliath. And in Ashdod, some remained. We will pick up that story when we meet the next time. So Joshua took the whole land according to all that the Lord had spoken to Moses, and Joshua gave it for an inheritance to the sons of Israel. Joshua gave it as an inheritance. So we have Jesus in the person of the Holy Spirit that is in us to give the Father the riches of the glory of his inheritance in us. That is, as Christ is being formed in us. And we have the Holy Spirit in us so that we can gain the riches of the glory of our inheritance in him. That's all found in Ephesians 1. We've covered this before. Joshua took the whole land according to all that the Lord had spoken to Moses, and Joshua gave it for an inheritance to Israel according to their divisions by their tribes. Thus the land had rest from war. Numbers 13, verse 33 talks about the progenitor of the Anakim, Anak. We'll visit that again. And then we'll turn to Joshua 14 and see who qualified to take down that hybrid stronghold, Kiriath Arba, so it could become Hebron, the place of fellowship, the place of the coming together that we see in 1 Chronicles 11 and 12. May we just close with this. You remember when Gideon, after the great victory that they had against the Midianites, they broke the vessels, the light came out, the mass armies were defeated, and then the armies of Gideon were pursuing them until they would wipe out all the remnants of that which was threatening Israel. And what does it say as they were pursuing? The battle had already been won, but it says they were weary, yet pursuing. That's Judges 8:4. Weary, but pursuing. Exhausted, but pursuing. That takes a lot of grace. Judges 8:4. And you might refer to David's mighty men in 2 Samuel 23:8-39 compared with 1 Chronicles 11. And we see the chapter 11 is preceded historically by what we see in 1 Chronicles 12. So everything that happened in 1 Chronicles 12 is the result of that which happened in 1 Chronicles 11. It has to do with David's mighty men. You can look that online. We have it posted for you. It is attaining unto the first three and David's mighty men. Meditate on that. You dig in. Start setting aside anything that the flesh says you need to be entertained. It's okay to rest, but this is the time to pursue because the enemy has not let up and he does not give up. We see in the book of Joshua, he never gives up. And yet, Joshua never gave up. And they continued the warfare until we see the result. And the land had rest from war. Now for us, war is going to go right up to the end. But I believe that as we approach the end, when the morning star arises in the hearts of his remnant, whatever's going on in the war for the outside, we're going to be in the rest of God. Hebrews 3, 7 through 6, verse 13. God has entered his rest. All works are completed to tetelestai in Christ. When we enter into the Father's rest in the heavenly man, Jesus Christ, then whatever remains of the battle, the Lord is going to set ambushes. He's going to have providential intervention. So that company that's raptured, we don't know all that's going to be going on, but it's going to be like a day that's never been before in history. Remember Joshua? This was a day never before or after it, like in the day of Joshua. That day is coming for the church. May we be ready. Father, we commit this to you and ask that you would guide and direct our lives, our thinking into that which will result in the glorification of our Lord Jesus Christ and see this age consummated. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.